Welcome friends to this session. As you are aware that tuberculosis is one of the important public health problem in our country, and if you are practicing in any specialty of medicine, directly or indirectly, you may keep into your mind the diagnosis of tuberculosis. So we thought that it is appropriate that we discuss this issue in bit detail. And to discuss this issue, we have today with us to my left Professor V.K. Vijayan. Professor Vijayan is a director at Patel Chest Institute in Delhi. And he will be discussing with you what are the different modalities and what are the different treatment regimes for tuberculosis. So I will request Dr. Vijayan to please start with the presentation, please.
Tuberculosis, as you all know, is an important public health problem in India. Though we have got cost-effective treatment, still tuberculosis continues a problem. You see that if you look at the global scenario, one third of the population are infected with tuberculosis, and in India it is 44% infected with the tuberculosis. You see, if I say infection, there is a difference between infection and disease. I will come to that one. The estimated cases of tuberculosis globally is 16 million, and in India it is 4.8 million. Every year 8 million new cases are produced globally and 1.8 million in India. 2 million patients die every year globally and 0.5 million in India. Therefore, you know that this is a very great problem globally as well as in India. If you look at the transmission of the infection, it is by droplet infection. The tubercle bacilli is by droplet infection is inhaled by an individual, and it is transmitted to the lung and reaches the lung, alveoli. In the alveoli, there are alveolar macrophages, and the tubercle bacillus, that is Mycobacterium tuberculosis, is taken up by this alveolar macrophages, and they form a primary complex. Most of the primary complex in the lung heals by itself. There is no need for treatment. However, in nearly 5% of individuals that is immunocompetent, they may develop tuberculosis disease within 1 or 2 years' time. And the rest 5% during the next lifetime. Therefore, in an immunocompetent individual, there is a 10% risk of development of the disease in the whole life. That means 90% individuals are infected without disease, 10% develop disease. Whereas if he is an immunodeficient individual, that is assumed he is an HIV positive individual, there is a 10% chance of development of disease within any year and 60% chance during their lifetime. Therefore, you can understand the problem of tuberculosis in an immunodeficient individual, especially HIV infected. See, this is the alveolar macrophage taken by broncho-alveolar lavage technique. You can see the red stain material is the tubercle bacillus. Therefore, the first cell that is encountered by the bacillus is the alveolar macrophage. If you want to treat tuberculosis properly, we should diagnose it properly. See, what is happening in the scenario, Indian scenario, is the patient comes to us, take an X-ray chest, any shadow is being treated as tuberculosis. That is not correct. We have to make a proper diagnosis for the treatment of tuberculosis. These are the diagnostic tools available. One is clinical characteristics. Second one is tuberculin skin testing, sputum smear microscopy, culture of mycobacteria, chest radiography, I put, you can see here, I put chest radiography on the lower part, not in the first. And a serology antigen detection testing and molecular diagnostic method. Among this, the most important diagnostic modality in the diagnosis of pulmonary tuberculosis is pure smear microscopy. This can be done even in a peripheral health center of the country. And even though the technique was described by the Cox more than a century ago, this still continues to be the best cheap available diagnostic modality of pulmonary tuberculosis. None of the tests, even though we have got so many sophisticated diagnostic modalities like PCR and etc., this is the test that is to be done for the diagnosis of pulmonary tuberculosis. See, this is the chest X-ray from a patient. You can see here there is infiltration in both lung field, both right side up, upper and mid zones, and the right side also mid zone. You can see here this is a typical X-ray findings in a patient with pulmonary tuberculosis. Still, you may suspect tuberculosis. You cannot treat this condition with pulmonary TB treatment unless you do a sputum microscopy and demonstrate that this are excreting tubercle bacilli. This patient has tubercle bacilli in the sputum. This is another chest X-ray. You can see here, this patient has got enlargement of the both hilar lymph nodes. See, this can also be confused with tuberculosis, but this is a patient with a sarcoidosis, therefore you have to differentiate. And another condition is miliary tuberculosis. You can see miliary shadows in chest X-ray. This is a case with miliary shadowing, but again, miliary shadows, differential diagnosis, tuberculosis is one of the diagnosis. This is a patient with topical eosinophilia. What I am pointing out is, you cannot treat X-ray shadows as tuberculosis unless there is evidence. And this is the sputum microscopy, AFB staining. You can see acid first bacilli in the sputum smear. Therefore, this is the diagnostic modality in pulmonary tuberculosis. Culture is there for definite diagnosis, but for a diagnostic purposes, sputum microscopy is the most important thing. Then the treatment of pulmonary tuberculosis is by short course chemotherapy. Before introduction of short course chemotherapy, the treatment of tuberculosis was 18 months to 12, sometimes 18 months, 12 months, but that is reduced to 9 months. Now the duration of treatment of pulmonary tuberculosis is 6 months and it is known as short course chemotherapy. And this is based on many parameters. That is, one is early killing, that is the killing of actively growing bacilli, that in the phase of rapid multiplication and uninhibited metabolic activity. This will occur when there is a large cavity, there will be large number of bacilli. And this situation, early killing is most important, and the most important drug in this case is rifampicin and isoniazid. The second one is sterilization activities, that is sterilization of persisting bacilli, that is metabolically inhibited organisms in a quasi-dormant state, and this also will be acted by rifampicin and isoniazid. The third one is ability to prevent resistance. This is achieved by ethambutol and thioacetyl. Therefore, these are the main factors that is involved in short course chemotherapy, and these are the most important drugs. See, again, treatment of tuberculosis can be given as a daily regimen or as an intermittent regimen. What I will be talking today is mainly based on our revised National TB Control Program, that is known as RNTCP. And in this program, it is not the daily regimen, it is the intermittent chemotherapy. What is the scientific basis for intermittent chemotherapy? There is a one factor known as lag period factor. You see, when tubercle bacilli are exposed to a drug for a short time, that means you put the tubercle sputum or tubercle bacilli in a medium and you see what is happening. After the bacilli is growing in the medium, you remove the drug. After careful removal of the drug, that means drug will be acting on the bacilli. After 24 hours, you remove the drugs and then transfer the bacilli into a drug-free medium. But what will happen is surviving bacilli will start growing again after an interval of several days. This is because initially the bacilli exposed to a drug that will inhibit the growth, then they remove the drugs, then put the bacilli into another medium, then they will start growing only after several days. This interval is called lag period. This principle is being utilized for introduction of intermittent chemotherapy. In the revised national TB program, the main aim is to achieve high cure rate of new smear positive patient. That is, I am always emphasizing new smear positive patient because they are infectious and they are spreading the disease to others. Therefore, the emphasis is on new smear positive patient. The target cure rate is at least 85%. Once you have achieved 85% of the cure rate, then the case detection rate is 70%. Now, all patients coming to you will not be tuberculosis patients. They are tuberculosis suspects. What is tuberculosis suspect? If there is persistent cough for 3 weeks or more, accompanied by one or more of the following symptoms, that is hemoptysis, weight loss, tiredness, fever, night sweats, etc., that patient is considered as a tuberculosis suspect. They are not tuberculosis cases, they are only suspects. Therefore, those coming with persistent cough for more than 3 weeks duration are suspects. When they come to the clinic, you have to collect 3 sputum specimens. These 3 sputum specimens should be collected within first 2 days of their attendance. Otherwise, if you delay the collection of the specimen, the patients will disappear. So they are not willing to come daily. Therefore, these 3 specimens should be collected in first 2 days. The first specimen is known as spot specimen. That is collected the first day of the attendance. That particular day, one sputum bottle is given to the patient and instructing the patient come to next day morning, and this is with the sputum in that bottle. This is known as early morning specimen. When he attends the next day, give one more bottle, and this is known as second spot specimen. Therefore, from each tuberculosis suspect patient, you have to collect 3 sputum specimens within 2 days' time. Now, after getting the sputum smear results from these specimens, you have to make a diagnosis. There are 2 types. One is pulmonary tuberculosis, another one is extrapulmonary tuberculosis. And among the pulmonary tuberculosis patients, one is classified as sputum smear negative, positive patient, other one is smear negative patient. And who is sputum smear negative, positive patient? Of the 3 sputum smears, if 2 of them are positive, that is classified as sputum smear positive patient. Sometimes what will happen is only 1 sputum smear is positive, 2 are negative. In that situation, if there is a radiographic abnormal, then you can take a chest x-ray. If 1 smear is positive, you can take a chest x-ray. If the medical officer feels that picture is consistent with tuberculosis, that is also classified as smear positive patient. Or if 1 culture is positive, one sputum positive and the culture is also positive, that is also classified as sputum smear positive patient. Therefore, these are the 3 groups falling into the category of sputum smear positive. The other one is sputum smear negative. If all the 3 sputum smears are negative, and in this situation you can take a radiograph, there is a radiographic abnormality, you can give antibiotic for 10 days or 14 days, then repeat the x-ray and do a sputum examination again, and the abnormality is persisting and the medical officer feels that is a tuberculosis, that is a sputum smear negative tuberculosis. Or all the sputum smears are negative and the culture is positive, that is also known as smear negative tuberculosis. The last one is extrapulmonary. Then after you are classified, 3 sputum smears are done, then classify the patient as sputum smear positive and smear negative, then you have to assess the severity of the TB disease. How will you assess the severity? This is depending upon the bacillary load, extent of disease, anatomic site. You see, with a cavity, there will be large number of patients, bacilli, that is a severe disease. Depending upon the anatomic site is acute threat to the life of the individual. When there is a pericardial tuberculosis, it's a severe form. When the risk of subsequent acute threat to the example, spinal tuberculosis, when there is meningeal TB, these are all severe forms of tuberculosis. And miliary and disseminate definitely is a severe form of disease. See, in the case of extrapulmonary tuberculosis also has to be classified as severe and less severe. Severe forms are meningeal, pericardial, peritoneal, bilateral, extensive pleural effusions, spinal, intestinal, genitourinary tuberculosis are classified as severe forms. Lymph node tuberculosis, pleural effusion only on one side, unilateral, bone excluding spine, and joints and skin are classified as less severe forms. Therefore, you have to classify the severity of the disease once it is diagnosed. After this, you have to decide the type of the patient before instituting the therapy. There are some type. One is known as new. The new patient should meet the following criteria. New patient is one who never considered as having acute tuberculosis in the past. Say this is a new patient only. He was never classified as or diagnosed as tuberculosis in the past. They are new patients. Or sometimes what will happen is a patient is diagnosed as tuberculosis as a new, but he might have received anti-tuberculosis treatment less than 1 month. That is also classified as new patient. Therefore, the new patients are those who have not received anti-TB treatment at all in the past, or even if they have received, it should be less than 1 month duration. The second one is relapse. What is meant by relapse? See, this type of patient might have received anti-TB treatment in the past and completed the course of treatment, and they have been declared as cured or completed treatment. And after some time, they will come back again with respiratory symptoms. If you do respiratory smear examination, if it is positive, that is classified as relapse. The third one is treatment after failure. Then a patient started on treatment, especially retreatment regimen, and if that patient has failed already in a previous treatment, that is known as treatment after failure. That's meant by he might have been started on a treatment, and he is failing on a treatment and starting on retreatment, that is known as treatment after failure. And some patient will be treatment after default. These type of patients will take treatment for 1 month and then disappear for more than 2 months. And they come back, and if the sputum smear is positive at the time of disappearance or continues to be smear positive, that is known as treatment after default. There are sputum smear positive patients. The fifth one is, see, this is a RNTCP based district as a unit. The patient treatment is started in a tuberculosis under wherever they identified by the government of India. But they can take, after starting the treatment, they can take treatment in another center convenient to the patient. Then they have to be transferred to that patient place. That is when they are receiving the patient from another center where it is received, that is known as transfer in. The last one is others. All the cases that do not fit in the above definition. This includes chronic cases. Chronic cases are those whose sputum smears are positive at the end of a retreatment regimen. I have told that another treatment after failure. Failure is you have started on a treatment regimen, sensitive, then they are failing and you are starting retreatment. That is failure. But here, those patients who have started a retreatment regimen also fails. Then they are classified as chronic case. Now these are the dosages of the anti-TB drugs. These are the essential anti-TB drugs. They are known as isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, streptomycin, and ethambutol. These are the essential anti-TB drugs and utilized for the treatment of the pulmonary tuberculosis. These are the dosages reduced. And daily also I given, and 3 times a week is also given. In our revised national TB control program, we are using the intermittent regimen, that is 3 times daily. And the dosage in RNTCP is based on the weight, that is less than 60 and more than 60 kg. And all these drugs, the dosage is similar, whether it is less than 60 or more than 60, except in the case of rifampicin, where the dosage is 450 milligram, if it is less than 60 kg, it is 600 milligram, if it is more than 60 milligram. In the case of streptomycin, if the patient is more than 60 years of age, you have to reduce the dose from 0.75 to 0.5 gram because the problem of ototoxicity in the elderly individuals. Now, what is this DOTS? See, we are all talking about DOTS, directly observed treatment short course. There are 5 components in this. One is sustained political commitment. What means if you don't have political commitment and give the adequate resources for implementing the problem, no program will be successful. Therefore, there should be sustained political commitment. There should be access to quality assured sputum microscopy. I told the sputum microscopy is the cheapest mode of diagnostic model. This should be made available every peripheral health institution. That is the second thing. The third one is standardized short course chemotherapy for all cases of TB and a proper case management condition, including the direct observation of treatment. See, DOT strategy is not only the observation of the treatment is given. They should have to see that whoever is administering the treatment, they should see that that particular patient is swallowing the drugs. Not like giving the drug and tell them to take the drug. Not like that. You have to see that that particular individual who is supervising it, see that the patient is consuming the drugs in his presence. That's the third component. And the fourth one is uninterrupted supply of quality assured drugs. We had an earlier program, tuberculosis program in India. We all know that that didn't succeed well. The problem was the quality assured drugs were not available at that time. Now the government of India has taken a policy that all patients diagnosed with pulmonary tuberculosis in the RNTCP program will have their complete course of IGTP drugs available till they complete the course. The last one is recording and reporting system, because once you start the treatment, we should know what is the outcome. So unless we know the outcome, we cannot find what the default, what are the faults in this system. And in order to have rectify this mistake, we should have complete monitoring and recording system. That is also incorporated. These are the five components of the DOT strategy. See, DOT sees, that is directly observed treatment short course, so with all the five components are there. This is recommended to all new smear positive cases of at least during the initial intensive phase, because short course chemotherapy has got two phases. One is known as intensive phase, the other one is continuation phase. All dosages, every dosages of intensive phase has to be directly under supervision. And if it is in the continuation phase also, it is advisable, but in the RNTCP, the drugs are collected once a week, but when they come for the collection, first dose is given under supervision, the other two are given to the patient for consumption. Third one is supervisors of baby health workers, trained health community workers and NGO workers. And this providing the facility, treatment facility should be as near to the patient home as possible, because most of the TB patients are poor patients. They cannot travel a long distance. Money is involved. Therefore, it is to be given very near to the patient home and should be integrated with the general health system. These are all done now. Now the treatment, there are mainly three categories. I will explain what are these categories. Category 1, 2, 3. Category 1 is short course chemotherapy of 6 weeks duration. I have told that there is an intensive phase of 2 months and a continuation phase of 4 months. The first is the months, that is 2 months. The other one is ethambutol, isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide. This is given 3 times a week. And this category 1 regimen is given to all smear positive new pulmonary tuberculosis patients. I have already defined what is a new pulmonary tuberculosis patient. They are also given seriously ill with severe forms of severe smear negative pulmonary tuberculosis and severe extra pulmonary tuberculosis. All severe forms of tuberculosis also will receive category 1, and also HIV disease with TB also will receive category 1. Therefore, after 2 months of intensive phase, sputum examination to be done in these patients. And the sputum smears, most of the subject, if they are new smear positive patient, if they have not received any anti-TB treatment in the past, nearly 80% of them will become smear negative at the end of 2 months. If they are sputum smear negative, you can go to the continuation phase of 4 months. Now there are no 4 drugs, there are only 2 drugs, that is isoniazid, rifampicin, again 3 times a week. And if the sputum smears are positive at the end of 2nd month, in nearly 10-15% of cases there may be sputum positivity, in that situation you can extend the intensive phase 1 more month, that is 4 drugs, ethambutol, isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, 3 times a week, extended for 1 more week, and make the intensive phase for 3 months and do the sputum smear exam at the end of the 3 months. In all the most of the cases of sputum smear negative cases, smear positive new cases, the sputum smears will be negative. Even in a small percentage of the patient, if it is positive, you can go to the continuation phase of 4 months. In this situation, the duration of the treatment will be 7 months, because you have extended 1 month intensive phase. And then what is happening is you continue the treatment and complete the treatment. Then coming to the category 2. Category 2 treatment is given to all sputum smear positive relapses. I have defined already what is relapse. Therefore, these patients are given category 2. And also those patients who are sputum smear positive failure cases. Defined as failure cases, those who have treated, they failed on that particular treatment and they are going to the retreatment regimen. That retreatment regimen is category 2. And also those who are defaulted, more than 2 months duration, and they are coming back again, and if the sputum smear is positive, they are also given category 2 regimen. During this category 2, the duration of treatment is not 6 months. The duration of treatment is 8 months. See, here intensive phase is 3 months. First 2 months, you will be giving 5 drugs. Streptomycin, ethambutol, isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide. Again, 3 times a week. After 2 months, you can omit streptomycin, continue 1 more month with 4 drugs, ethambutol, isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, again 3 times a week. At the end of the 3 months, you have to do a sputum smear examination. If it is negative, you continue to the continuation phase here is 5 months, not 2 drugs. In category 1, it was 2 drugs. Here there are 3 drugs of 5 months duration, that is isoniazid, ethambutol, and rifampicin, again 3 times a week. If 3rd month, at the end of 3 months, the sputum smear is positive, there are possibilities in this situation, positivity, because you have included failure cases and treatment after fall. If sputum smear is positive at the end of 3rd month, you extend the continuation phase 1 more month with these 4 drugs, ethambutol, isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, and at the end of 4th month, you do the sputum smear examination. If it is negative, go to the continuous 5 months, then it will become 9 months duration. In case that under 4 months duration, if it is positive, you have to consider, you can continue continuous phase, but you have to send the sputum smear examination for culture examination. And there are specified centers in India where you can do culture and sensitivity. And till that time you get the result, you continue the continuation phase. The category 3 is the last category in this group. And these are all patients who will be sputum smear negative patients. Sputum smear negative severe forms will go to category 1. Smear negative pulmonary tuberculosis, not severe, they will be getting category 3. And extra pulmonary tuberculosis, not severely ill, will also get category 3. When they are severely ill, they will go to category 1. When sputum smear negative pulmonary TB or extra pulmonary TB, if they are not seriously ill, they will get 6 months short course chemotherapy. Here again there is an intensive phase of 2 months, but intensive phase is only with 3 drugs, not 4 drugs. The drugs are isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, again 3 times a week. And at the end of intensive phase of 2 months, you have to do a sputum examination. These patients, before putting on the anti-TB drugs, were sputum smear negative. They cannot be sputum smear positive at the end of 2 months. If they are negative, you go to the continuation phase of 4 months. But in certain situations, when there is a positivity at the end of 2 months, that means these patients have developed resistance or your laboratory evaluation initially was wrong. When that situation arises, you have to take the patient out of this category and classify as failure and go to the category 2. Then I have mentioned there are 3 important categories. There is one more category that is known as category 4. These are for chronic and MDR TB cases. What is the chronic case? I already mentioned. This is a patient with TB who is sputum smear positive at the end of a standard retreatment regimen. They were already on retreatment regimen. I told the 4th month or 5th month they will be positive. They are chronic cases and they should be given category 4 regimen. And in this situation, there should be specially designed, standardized or individual regimen. If you got a culture and sensitivity result, it will be individualized. Otherwise, there can be standardized regimen. I will come to that. Now you started anti-TB drugs, then you have to monitor the treatment. I told after intensive phase, 2 or 4 months, you will be doing the sputum smear examination. Then 2 months into the category, you have to do the sputum smear examination. It may be 3rd or 4th month, and 5th or 6th month, and in the case of category 1 and 2, and also you have to do at the end of the treatment. Therefore, 2 months into the treatment of the continuation phase, you have to do the futile smear examination, and also at the end of the treatment. These are the time points you have to do the futile smear examination. The after treatment, you have to define the outcome. One is cured. The definition of cure is the treatment has been completed, and the sputum smear is negative in the last month of treatment and on at least one previous occasion. These are the results. Sputum smear negativity is there, and that is known as cured. What will happen in certain situations, patient may not be able to produce the sputum, but they might have taken the anti-TB drug regularly and completed the treatment. But because we didn't have sputum smear examined to classify them as cure, that is classified as treatment completed. And some of them will die during whatever cause, during the anti-TB, they are classified as died. And then the treatment failure, here is sputum smear positive. There are three situations. One is smear positive. At the end of 5 months or more, it is continued to be positive. There is a failure. And the patient might have stopped treatment for more than 2 months before the fifth month and continues to be sputum smear negative. There are also failures. And I have told the category 3 regimen. The sputum is positive at the end of 2 months. That is also classified as treatment failure. The other one is sputum smear negative defaulted, because they might be defaulting for more than two months, but when they come back, sputum smear continues to be negative, that is default as sputum negative. Transfer out, as I told in the case of transferring, some of the patient will be transferred to another district or another tuberculosis unit for the continuation of the treatment, that is transfer out. Now, another question always asked is, what is the role of corticosteroids in the treatment of tuberculosis? See, the only absolute indication for steroids in tuberculosis is only adrenal tuberculosis. But there are certain situations where controlled clinical trials have shown that it will be useful in pericardial effusions. If there are certain other situations like massive pleural effusion, massive peritoneal effusion, tuberculosis eye, larynx, tuberculosis meninges, these are all indications where corticosteroids are given, but we still do not have properly controlled clinical trial to say it is useful. But in the case of pericardial effusion, there are studies. And adrenal tuberculosis, it is an absolute indication. Now coming to the drug resistant, there are 4 types: natural, primary, initial, secondary or acquired resistance. What is natural drug resistant? See, there is a wild strain. If that wild strain, if that is not exposed to any anti-TB drugs, and if that strain develops resistance, kind of mutation, a spontaneous mutation, if they are developing resistance without exposure to drugs, that is known as natural drug resistance. This will occur in areas where anti-TB drugs have never been used. That is not possible in India, everywhere it is used. Therefore, that is natural drug resistance. The another one is primary drug resistance. In this situation, an individual gets a disease from another individual. That particular individual has developed acquired drug resistance. He has irregular treatment. He had got drug resistance. And that particular acquired drug resistant organism is given to a new patient. He gets the disease. Actually, this particular individual, new patient, is never exposed to any anti-TB drugs. But he has got drug resistant organ. That is known as primary drug resistance. The third one is initial drug resistance. You see, when a patient comes, we question the patient immediately, even though he has received the treatment in the past, anti-TB, immediately you say, I have not received any treatment. That's the first response. When we probe them, they will concede that they have got some treatment earlier and now they have got resistance. Therefore, this initial drug resistance is, see, there are some undisclosed drug resistance, they will deny it. Or the patient may not be aware he has received anti-TB treatment in the past. That is known as initial drug resistance. The next one is secondary drug resistance. And this situation is due to mismanagement. This is a man-made situation. Both doctors and patients are responsible for this because of the irregular treatment of the patient. They are developing drug resistance. This is the main problem in our country now. Not properly treated. And if you treat all patients properly, we can reduce drug resistant problem. Because that, for that only, we have to have a uniform policy for treatment of tuberculosis. Then comes to the multi-drug resistance. See, multi-drug resistance is the most potent anti-TB drugs are today is rifampicin and isoniazid. When there is resistance to rifampicin isoniazid, that is classified as multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. If you diagnose a case of MDR tuberculosis, that is a death warrant to the patient. Again, I am re-emphasizing, this is the fault of doctors and patients. It is not because we didn't have a potent chemotherapeutic regimen and we have got the most potent, most effective drug available today, but that is not being utilized properly for the management of the patient, and that is why multi-drug resistance is coming up. This is MDR TB is due to prescription of inadequate chemotherapy. Now in India, any type of anti-TB treatment is available from any pharmacy to anybody. That is being indiscriminately being used. Poor management of drug supply, the use of drugs of unproven bioavailability. See, drug companies are coming out, fixed combinations, without any bioequivalent studies. Whether the required levels of anti-drugs are available in that, we don't know. These are all responsible multi-drug resistant. And the poor case management, or when the patient is not properly observed for treatment. Again, as I told, it's a death warrant to the patient. Then there are two situations. One is known as MDR TB suspect. When will you suspect the patient? Just in the cases of pulmonary TB suspect, you should also suspect MDR TB. That is when a category 2 patient who is smear positive at the end of 4th month, they continue to come with symptoms, then they are suspected. See, when you suspect a MDR TB patient, that means at the end of 4th month, in the category 2 regimen, sputum smear positive, in that situation, you have to confirm by culture, that is isoniazid and rifampicin resistant. That is confirmed MDR TB case. Now, a new term is introduced now in the last 1 year, that is known as extensively drug resistant TB, that is XDR. You see, MDR TB is resistant to most important drug, that is first line drug, that is isoniazid rifampicin. But in this extensively drug resistant TB, here in addition to resistant isoniazid rifampicin, they are also resistant to second line drugs. See, the XDR TB is that is resistant to any fluoroquinolone and at least one of the 3 injectable second line drugs, that is capremycin, kanamycin, amikacin, in addition to MDR TB. They are in addition resistant to rifampicin isoniazid. This has been classified at WHO recently in October 2006. That is a big problem. We do not have any drug for treatment of this situation. So why I am emphasizing on these points are, we can prevent these things as doctors. Now there is another strategy that is not being implemented all over, but you should know what is DOTS plus. DOTS plus strategies for the management of MDR TB cases. See, DOTS plus is a comprehensive management strategy that includes all the 5 tenets of the DOTS. Already I mentioned what are the 5 that is involved here also. It takes into account specific issues, such as the use of second line anti-TB drugs in areas where there is a high prevalence of MDR tuberculosis. And it works as a supplement to DOTS strategy. And standardized or individual regimens with second line drugs are used in this situation and should be implemented in selected areas. It cannot be implemented in all areas. There will be facilities for culture examinations, and so many issues are involved here. But now DOTS plus strategy is available for the management of MDR TB cases. These are the reserve anti-TB drugs. There should be 1 injectable drug. Injectable drugs are amikacin, capremycin, kanamycin, and other drugs are cyclosurine, etanamide, ciprofloxacin, ofloxacin, paraminosalicylic acid, PIS, was used earlier. It was stopped now, but now for MDR-TB cases, in some situations you can use, and also prothionamide. These are the drugs available. Now currently available for management of MDR-TB cases, but in extremely drug resistant, these are also ineffective. What are the principles of management of MDR-TB? It is in the drug-sensitive organisms, intensive phase is 2 months. But here, it should be at least 4 months, including an injectable drug and a fluoroquinolone in the initial phase. And intensive phase should be at least 6 months duration. They have to be given all drugs for 6 months. The continuation phase should be at least with 3 of the most active and most best tolerated drug. That the reason being, most of the second line drugs are very toxic. They cannot tolerate. Everybody will not tolerate. But we have to see what is being tolerated. The best tolerated drug should be given, and should be given at least for 12 to 14, 18 months. Therefore, when a patient develops MDR-TB, the duration of treatment is nearly 24 months. It cannot be 6 months. Very long period of time. Still, it is very difficult to treat. Wherever possible, we have to do the drug susceptibility testing and standardize regimens where susceptibility testing is not available. If you cannot do the susceptibility testing, you can use standardized regimens. This is the standardized treatment regimen for MDR-TB recommended in our program. See here, what is being given is initial 6 months of, sometimes may go up to 9 months depending upon the sputum smear results, kanamycin, ofloxacin, etanamide, cycloserine, pyrazinamide, and ethambutol. You can see here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 drugs are given, to be given, for minimum for 6 months. And depending upon the sputum smear, if it is possible, it should be extended up to 9 months. And the continuation phase with 4 drugs, that is ofloxacin, etanamide, cycloserine, and ethambutol, minimum duration of 18 months. Therefore, minimum duration of treatment of multi-drug resistant tuberculosis is 24 months. This is a standardized regimen recommended by Government of India. If you have got the culture facilities, you can change the regimen depending upon the culture result. But that is not available in many centers. What I have talked today is with regard to the revised National TB Control Program, emphasizing on the regular treatment of pulmonary tuberculosis, especially sputum smear negative patients to be adequately treated. Then we can prevent the development of emergence of multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. Once it is developed, it is very difficult to treat, and now the development of extensively drug resistant is a very highly alarming situation. Thank you very much.
I hope our DNB candidates who are watching this program, they have greatly benefited from this session. I again want to re-emphasize, you may be doing DNB program in any specialty, but you cannot afford to miss proper treatment of tuberculosis. So we thought that it is important for all of us to know about the standard management of a tuberculosis case. As Professor Vijayan has very rightly highlighted, most of the time we think that high and sophisticated investigation can give you better clues, but he said the simple sputum examination in tuberculosis is very good enough to diagnose. Then he has also given different steps for management. He has given different type of regimens which should be given to a patient with tuberculosis. And he has also very rightly mentioned what are the different types of drug resistance and how to manage that drug resistance. I will now request Dr. Menon, if you can, would you like to add in the concluding remarks about the management of tuberculosis?
Well, as you know, tuberculosis is a very important disease in India. It involves over a third of our population. And it's very important for doctors of all specialties. As it has been said, all specialties deal with tuberculosis. All of you will be seeing cases of tuberculosis in your respective specialties. So you should know the diagnosis of tuberculosis. You should be aware of the fact that pulmonary tuberculosis is the most common association to tuberculosis anywhere in the body. So these are two important things. And one thing which I would like to emphasize is that the treatment of tuberculosis stays the same for tuberculosis anywhere in the body. In the past, it was well known that certain forms of tuberculosis had to be treated for longer periods of time. However, under the WHO program and the revised National TB program of India, it is stated that tuberculosis all over the body is to be treated within these categories of treatment. And it is not that individual treatment regimens may have to be undergone in such some conditions, but under program conditions, they are to be treated in this manner. Along with this, we should be aware of the fact that tuberculosis is a great mimic, and the diagnosis of tuberculosis would involve diagnosis in other organs of the body as well. So the revised National TB program must be known by all students, and you should be aware of the complications of tuberculosis.
Thank you, Dr. Menon. I will request Dr. Vijayan to give in 2-3 minutes.
I will just give one
some key tips to
us. Key tips I will tell you. I wanted to say another one. Nowadays we are seeing many patients coming with antigen antibody test in the blood. You were saying that this tuberculosis. But this has to be discouraged. There is no role for antigen antibody detection. ELISA, they are all coming with ELISA. Should not be done, and it is not be encouraged. in the treatment diagnosis of pulmonary tuberculosis, any form of tuberculosis. And another important issue is HIV and tuberculosis. See, I have not touched upon HIV and tuberculosis. That itself requires 40-45 minutes. Therefore, if national board is willing, we can do some
sure,
other
sir.
Day.
We can plan for more session for the benefit of the students. I hope the DNB students who are watching this program, they have greatly benefited from this interaction. I take this opportunity to express on behalf of the National Board of Examination our gratitude to Professor V.K. Vijayan. He is a very busy person, director of a very important premier institution, and his colleague Dr. Menon, who have come here and they have made lot of efforts. So I thank you again. And for our DNB candidates, this is for information that we are breaking for 15 minutes. And at 3:30 we are coming back and will continue with the diagnostic procedure in dermatology. And then there will be one more session in dermatology covering some basic specialties, how they are important for the specialty of dermatology. So thank you very much, and do join us at 3:30.